We have Virginia head coach Tony Bennett, accompanied by student athletes Kyle Guy, DeAndre Hunter, and Ty Jerome. Just a few reminders, the locker room is open at this time, and then we will begin the questioning after an opening statement from Coach Bennett. We'll have questions directed to the student athletes and allow them to be released after you're finished with them.
Sure. I thought the way these guys in the last part of this first half to get it back to a six-point game was pivotal for us because Gardner-Webb's good. They move hard. They're quick. We understood that. They had a great backing. You could feel that. And but I thought the way these guys came out and fought, and then in the second half, there's a few adjustments that we did, but these guys really stepped up and played. And that's a pressure. There's no doubt about it. You know, when you're in that spot, you feel the crowd, but it's something we had to go through. And I'm glad I'm up here this year and feeling a little different than I had Ty and Kyle with me last year. But it's the beauty of the tournament. You just don't know. But we played well in the second half and the end of the first half, which we needed to do. And I was proud of these guys, the way they responded when, you know, it got a little, it was just intense. That's the reality of it.
First question here in the yellow shirt, right side.
Gene Wong with the Washington Post. DeAndre, I know you said the other day you didn't really go through your head what you could have contributed last season, but it sure looked like you were trying to make up for lost time in the second half. How much did you take it upon yourself to kind of make sure you guys were going to advance this time?
I was just trying to score in the flow of the offense. I didn't really try to play outside of it. I just tried to be aggressive when my team needed me and make shots.
Back row on the right side.
Dick Cox with Lindy Sports and Cox Sports Broadcasting for the players. What did you learn from last year's disappointment that you think maybe helped to get you through the adversity that you went through first half today?
I'll start with Ty.
Oh, that's crazy. I think the first thing is we came into this game knowing real well we were going to be in for a battle. It wasn't going to be, you know, last year was our first time being a one seed. So we came into this game knowing how capable Gardner-Webb was going to be. And they punched us in the mouth. But we just said, like, we've been in that position before. You know, we were at Louisville down 14 or 15, and we came back and won that game. So it's just about doing what we do, staying united, not looking around, just staying in the moment.
Kyle?
Yeah, we had an author come and talk to us last year, Joshua Metcalf, and one of the things he said always stuck with me was be where your feet are. So, you know, some of those outside pressures that can, you know, creep into our minds is all external, and it comes from thinking too much about the future, too much about the past. So we just tried to, you know, be where our feet were and just, you know, positive reinforcement all the time and stay united, like Ty said.
Center aisle on the right.
Ty and Jerome, DeAndre, what kind of sparked your second half individual performances? Was one of those situations where things kind of snowballed for you when you saw some shots going? What really sparked, or what you guys were able to do in the second half?
DeAndre first and then Ty.
Oh, yeah, like I said, I was just being more aggressive. Got some easy buckets at the rim, got a couple and-ones, got the energy going up. So I feel like that just helped us in the second half, and he started to make shots as well. So I feel like those shots going in just helped our team momentum a lot.
For me, it was just about coming out and being in attack mode, trying to touch the paint, get guys shots, and just if shots didn't fall, keep telling them, keep shooting them. You know what I mean? As long as we get good shots, I could live with whatever happens. So I just told my guys to keep letting it fly, especially Kyle, because, you know, he's been doing it all year. So Kihei, Kyle, Mommy gave us a huge lift in the second half. And like you said, Dre was great. So for us, but the main thing was stops. It was just if we knew if we can get stops, the ball would eventually go in. So for us, it was really about getting stops.
Front row, right side.
Paul Woody, Richmond Times-Dispatch for the players. At each timeout, it seemed like Coach Bennett was saying things to you to either to keep you calm or to keep your heads in the game. And then what was he saying during the first half? And what did you guys talk about at halftime that enabled you to come out and play as you did at the start of the second half?
Kyle first.
No, sir. You know, these answers are going to become redundant, but that's what got us through the game. And like Ty said, we knew we were in for a battle. And Coach reminded us that we already knew that, and we've stood the test of time. So now we're just, you know, playing our game and staying in attack mode and getting stops and getting good looks, and we'll live with the outcome.
Well, midway back. Oh, sorry. Go ahead. Ty.
Yeah, every time out, we had a different mindset. Because, I mean, I remember last year, halftime against UMBC, one of our coaches came in screaming at us. And we got
so, doing an interview with
so he, I think they, we felt their panic last year at halftime, and that was one thing I remember of not doing a good job keeping everyone calm. That's something I pride myself on too. So I think every time out, it was just a matter of keeping guys calm, but also keeping our edge. You know, you got to find a balance. You can't come out just everything's going to be okay, stay calm. So just trying to find the right balance of staying calm and keeping our edge.
On the right side.
DeAndre, after one of your three-pointers, you sort of spread your arms really wide and smiled. After not being able to play in this tournament last year, how gratifying was it for you to be able to contribute and hit some of those three-pointers?
Oh, it was great. I was having fun. Just like Kyle said, I was just being in the moment, being where my feet were. And I did that because I was happy I was missing some, so I made that one. I was real excited.
The last question for the student athletes here on the front.
Yeah, I just want to ask Ty, talk about, you mentioned Mamadi. Talk about his development offensively, and do you look for him more now than you did maybe earlier in the year?
I think the biggest difference, well, first of all, it's not, we don't necessarily look for certain people. Like, we're never going to not throw a ball to somebody that's open, you know what I mean? So for us, it's just about getting the best shot you possibly can. But I think the biggest difference, what I was most proud of Mamadi for, is he did something today where I don't know if he could have done it in the beginning of the year. He came out and he had a shaky start, and the way he responded was huge for us. We needed every bit of it, and that's something he definitely couldn't do last year, and that's just a testament to his growth as a person, really, more than a player, just his ability to respond and fight through adversity.
Thank you, guys. Questions for Coach? We'll start here, second row in the green shirt.
Aaron McFarling with the Roanoke Times. Tony, was that a conscious thing to try to stay a little calmer and keep everybody a little calmer in the halftime locker room this time around?
No,
and what was your message?
Well, it was a different halftime than last time. It was just the ability, because I thought we had fought back, as I mentioned, at the end of the first half to get ourselves in a spot where it was a lot of basketball left. But that's one thing I said to my staff. We just talked right before we went in there. I said, uplift them, and we'll talk about them. We talked about don't panic, but play with fight, because that's what got him back in. When you look at the stat sheet, I think the difference was some offensive rebounds, some scrambling for loose balls. We had 10 steals. I don't know how many we had in the second half versus the first half. Yes, we made some adjustments that I think helped the guys out there, but it was, you know, don't you dare leave anything in this locker room. You don't panic, but you play the right way I don't know if it's calm is the right word, but I thought that they did that with the fight. But last year, you can feel that. You could feel it a little bit at the game. And you ask any coach who's been in that game, and it gets tight. And we're the only one who's experienced the other side of it. But that's real stuff. And I thought the guys just kept plugging. And Gardner-Webb missed some shots. Maybe they got fatigued. But I thought the resolve of our team was good to weather that storm and have a good second half.
Front row on the right.
Yes. Tony, you guys outscored them 22-5 to start the second half. It looked like you were, to build that lead, it looked like you were attacking inside. Was that part of your strategy at halftime?
Yeah, I mean, it was just we wanted to give them something where they could be assertive and not mix things up and say, hey, run this, run that. Just here's our base and play out of it and get on the glass, because I thought we'd do that. And if there's something inside, yes, try to get to the lane. And then, you know, obviously some shots went down. And it was definitely part of it. We had to, without forcing or taking too many bad shots. So I thought there was a good balance.
Front row on the left, Richard.
Richard Walker, Gaston Gazette, Shelby Star. What did you know about Gardner-Webb, and what did they do that was so effective for them early on?
Yeah, I knew. Well, one of our assistant coaches, Kyle Getter, was at Liberty with Coach McKay, and just watching them play. I watched them against, you know, Georgia Tech, Wake Forest. Even Virginia Tech, they didn't have DJ the first half against them. But then in the tournament, how, you know, when you play teams that are five guards or four guards that shoot 40% from the three, their offense is fast, they slip ball screens, that was hard. We tried to prepare as well as we could, and it was we struggled. And I think the nerves were there, but they were banging shots and had us chasing, and they did a good job defensively. So we had all the respect. Those guys said it right. You know that. Certain teams and matchups are challenging. I mean, they all are at this level, but That's a tough one. You don't play a lot of teams like that in the ACC, and their quickness was noticeable, how fast they played offensively. And then, again, we, you know, turned it over. We were a little tight, I think, early with our turnovers, and all that started feeding in. And it, in some ways, it felt like a road game with the crowd, too. So being, you know, less than 2 hours, Gardner-Webb people came out and supported them. But the Virginia faithful were there, too. So you had a lot of those dynamics going. But much respect for Coach Kraft. He's good, really good.
Back row on the left. And
Tony, Pete Iacobelli, Associated Press. Do you feel like today's win kind of, I don't know, gets you past what happened last year, and now these guys maybe can relax a little bit and play in the NCAA tournament?
Did you watch Oklahoma play? I didn't get to watch it, but my staff said they were impressive. That will always be part of our story. I understand that. And, you know, I'm sure a lot of people thought it was going to be part of our story a second year in a row. But it's just now, this is a new year. This is trying to be in the moment. And that's a challenge to the best of your ability. So now you get your rest, you prepare for Oklahoma, and get ready. So I'll tell you that after the game on Sunday. But I think it was important that for those guys, a lot of them, you know, were hoping to be in this position again. And they stepped to the challenge, even though it was a little wobbly at times.
Front row on the right.
Paul Woody, Richmond Times-Dispatch. Tony, you were talking about scrambling for loose balls and being more aggressive. One guy who seemed to be really doing that quite a bit was Kihei.
Yep.
Would you mind talking about what he gave you today and what Mamade gave you today?
Yeah, for sure. I think, you know, when you go against these quick teams, you have to sometimes match their quickness to the best of your abilities. And last year we didn't have Kihei or DeAndre, so that allowed us to be a little more versatile, to match their quickness, and then to switch some of those ball screens. And, you know, they, I thought his competitiveness and his ability to come up with loose balls was significant. Banged a three, just did some things that were good. He played, obviously, very poised and well for a first year. And then Mamadi, I think Ty hit it on the head, and it wasn't all Mamadi's fault. It was just a little hard early, getting used to their pace. And, again, we made some adjustments that helped him defensively. But, boy, he really did a good job on the glass, playing hard, finishing some stuff. And that lift was huge because you have to get some easy baskets. You can't just live and die by the three. And I thought we tried to do a little better this time.
Coach, thank you. We've hit our time.
Thank you.
Gardner-Webb head coach Tim Kraft with student athletes David Effiani, DJ Laster, Brandon Miller, and Jose Perez. Coach, a brief opening statement, and then we'll open the floor to questions of our student athletes. Once the questions are finished with our students, we'll then allow questions to be directed to coach.
Yeah, I'm just unbelievably proud of our team, for really just our entire season. And this hurts to lose, but, our second half, we just didn't play particularly well, and I thought Virginia had a lot to do with that. And I think Virginia's a terrific team, obviously, but just really proud of our group, proud of these guys up here and all the guys in our locker room and what they've done for our school, for our university, for our alumni, our former players, our community. This run that they've been on has just done so much for a lot of people in our area and that are associated with Gardner-Webb. So just very thankful to coach this group of guys, to coach these three seniors, and, just very, very thankful.
First question in the back on the right side.
Dick Cox with Lindy Sports and Cox Sports Broadcasting. This is for the players. Talk about the great start you got off to and the support from your fans. It looked like you really fed off your fans in the first half.
Let's start with David.
Yes, sir. I think we just came out with a lot of energy. We were moving the ball well, and we were making great shots. So,
DJ?
Yeah, at the beginning of the first half, our fans really had us going, and we fed off their energy, and we were just playing well as a team, passing the ball, making the right cuts, and making the right plays. And it was a really good experience for them to all show support, and even at the end, they were still showing support.
Brandon?
Pretty much the beginning of the game, the nerves kick in. Everyone's excited. We're moving the ball, we're scoring. The first bucket, everyone's going crazy. First one for us in March Madness, it's a great experience. And the fans, the best I've ever seen it in my 5 years, that really motivated us to do better and just, keep the Gardner-Webb happy at the end of the day.
Jose?
It was a great atmosphere here. I just want to thank the fans for traveling from Bowling Springs down here. It's a small town, and it was about 1,000 people here just supporting us. It was a great atmosphere.
Front row, Richard.
Richard Walker, Gaston Gazette, Shelby Star. Obviously, first time, we've written a lot about that. You mentioned a little bit of it, Brandon, for the players. Y'all didn't seem to play nervous early on. Was because it was going well. I mean, everything looks good when shots are falling, but how did you fight off not being nervous coming into this historic first game for you?
I mean, we just played our game, it's at the end of the day, we all strap up the same way, So no matter what school you're going to, at the end of the day, the ball goes in one hoop, So for us, it was just being ready, being prepared. We had a couple days to prepare. Practice was crazy good, A lot of guys communicating, talking, and at the end of the day, we want to win, and we didn't really care about anything else but winning. So definitely us staying locked in, staying together, and just communication is best. Guys are just flowing together, No one wants to be a ball hog today and be a hero. And that's something that really lightened my eyes, It's a guy that didn't play much, but such an experience, a crazy experience, and something I'll never forget.
Left side in the blue shirt.
Brandon, you mentioned that Jeffrey Collins with the Associated Press, you mentioned that you wanted to win, but, when you get some time to kind of look back on this, you won the Big South tournament with two road games. Yeah, it wasn't happily ever after with Cinderella, but you were up 14 in the first half. Is there something that you think when you have a little time and distance to look at, you'll be like, that was pretty amazing?
It's amazing, but you don't want to settle for that. You want more out of it. Yes, we have a lead, but we want more. We're hungry for more. It's not enough for us just to settle for, we're up 14, then all of a sudden give up the lead, We're dogs, at the end of the day, we want to just keep pushing that lead as much as we can, and it didn't go our way like we wanted it to. They figured it out a little bit, but this is just motivation for the guys coming up next, especially for Jose and all of them. They're going to stay hungry, and then they'll be back next year for sure.
Back row.
I know the end result was not what you wanted, but what does it mean to each one of the players to have the opportunity to participate in March Madness and in the NCAA tournament?
You can go ahead and start, Brandon. Or whoever wants to jump in. But
It's a dream come true. As a player, you want to play at the highest level, and March Madness is basically the high level in college. So it's a dream come true for me and for all the guys just to be playing at this at the highest level.
Yeah, like you said, it's just a great experience, like something I'll never forget, something I could tell my kids that I participated in, and just it's just good that we were able to do it for the school and do it for the community also. And I just thank God just giving us the opportunity to play in this, and just through success and failure, I still give God all the glory for just giving us the opportunity to compete and play against the number one seed and showing that we can compete with them in the first half. We just let it go a little bit, but still give God the glory through success and failure.
Brandon.
For me, it was unforgettable. You know, I could carry this on for the rest of my life and no one could take it from me. You know, you can do what you want at the end of the day, but, you know, we're conference champs. We made history in Gardner-Webb, and that's something that no one could take from us, and we take pride in that. And it was, you know, I'm going to dream about this tonight for sure. It was a great experience, and the fans have been amazing, and no better way to go out senior year than, you know, going to March Madness.
Jose?
Well, as a freshman, playing in March Madness is like definitely a dream come true, and being a part of it with these guys, they're like family, especially Dave, DJ, and Brandon. Like, those are guys that in practice push me every day, even when I was going through the motions sometimes. And they just push me to become better every day. And you can see that we can compete with anybody. Unfortunately, we didn't come out with the win today, though.
Last question for the students, front right.
Richard Walker, Gaston Gazette, shall we start for you, Jose? Obviously, those three seniors you say have pushed you. You've talked a lot about how the seniors have tried so hard to get to this point. You've got a chance to come back. How much have you learned through this process, and how much of their leadership will help going forward with the program?
I've learned a ton from them. They're like my role models, even though I don't tell them, because they'll probably pick on me for that. But, yeah, I learned a lot from them on and off the court, like how to move and stuff like that. And it's just great. It's sad it had to end today, though.
Thank you, guys. Questions for Coach Kraft? In the back row, plaid shirt.
Hey, Tim. Jonathan Jones, SI.
How you doing, Jonathan?
Good to see you, Tim.
Good to see you.
In the second half, as they decided to, you know, use their size to their advantage a lot more, how difficult is it for your guys to cover a guy like DeAndre Hunter, who is NBA lottery pick, and, you know, they're able to kind of really stretch out that four?
Yeah, I mean, I think it was difficult for everybody in the ACC this year for the most part, so it was going to be a difficult challenge for us. And, you know, we ended up, you know, they beat us up on the glass. I thought they made some good adjustments both offensively and defensively. To exploit some areas that in the beginning, in the first half, they weren't. But they were getting it on those pick and rolls, like right to the block, and being able to kind of finish over our smaller size. And then when they missed jumpers, you know, they were getting them back a lot early. And you know, credit those guys for getting to the glass, for fighting on the glass. And it, you know, I was a little disappointed with our effort on the defensive glass. I didn't think it was obviously not good enough, but I did think that they made some good adjustments to kind of get it to a spot that was hard for us to guard. And Hunter was, yeah, I mean, he's a monster for us to guard and most of the country.
Staying in the back row.
Josh Kendall with the State. How did you approach halftime? What was going on in your mind, and what did you tell the team?
Well, you know, we felt like we had a great half, obviously, you know, we talked about some of the things that we felt like led to us getting stops and led to us being able to get good shots, and just kind of emphasized trying to continue to do those things. We really emphasized trying to communicate defensively on that far end, because they weren't going to have our bench, you know, kind of talking to them and calling things out and to try to stay connected there. And, you know, I think in that first 4 minutes, I really thought that first 4 minutes was going to be critical, whichever way it went. You know, if we were able to make a run there early, you know, maybe we put a little pressure on them. But that didn't happen. And I thought when you know, they made a couple buckets and we struggled to score and had some bad offensive possessions, then we started to break down defensively. You know, we started to give stuff up that we didn't give up in the first half. And, you know, some of that was mental, just you know, not responding to adversity in the way that we needed to. That was unfortunate. But I thought that Virginia really made some great adjustments there, you know, to attack us in some weak spots. But that's what we talked about at halftime. We just tried to kind of emphasize the game plan again and just said, hey, let's try to do it again for another 20 minutes. No, it was all just about, hey, here's what we've done well. Hey, in that last 4 minutes, they got a couple offensive rebounds. We got to keep you know, we got to keep fighting on the glass. You know, here's the keys that we talked about before the game. Let's make sure we're continuing to do these things well, and let's make sure we stay connected down on that far end, because, you know, we're not going to be in your ear. And when they make a run, because they're going to make a run, we better stay together and be able to make enough, you know, come back and have good offensive possessions. But no, I mean, you know, we're trying, you know, we came into the game obviously knowing we're playing a great team, but we certainly came into the game with a game plan and with good players that we felt like if we have a chance to execute, we'll have a chance in the end.
Front row, Richard. Final question,
Walker,
for Coach.
Gaston Gazette, Shelby Star. Coach Bennett referenced that last 4 minutes of the first half and thought that kind of gave them a little bit of momentum. You know, surprised that you started as well as you did, and did you think that that kind of shifted the game's momentum?
Well, I wouldn't say I was surprised necessarily. I mean, you hope to start well. I mean, you prepare to play well. So when you play well, you know, I don't think that you're going to be surprised. But our guys were played with a lot of confidence. You know, I think probably them talking about some things in timeouts, talking about some things at halftime, as the game wore on and they got a little bit of a rhythm guarding us. And they made some adjustments. They started switching Jose Perez's pick and rolls, which he had made some threes early, so that took his threes away. Then we were trying to post him on the smaller zero, their point guard, and then they were doubling the posts, and we just didn't handle that great. And DJ Laster had some success there inside early, and they, you know, then they began to double the post, and then, you know, their length bothered us when they came with the double teams, and we were getting passes deflected, and just our offensive rhythm was out of sorts. That last 3 minutes, and then I thought, you know, a lot of the second half as well.
Thank you, Coach.
Thank you.